So say you're me and you're at school getting ready to teach a class and you get another memo about, well, who knows what the memo is about. Probably another meeting agenda or a training seminar they'd want you to attend. And while you're likely to learn something illuminating and innovative and maybe even life-changing from the speaker talking at you, you'll be away from work, which means you'll have a lot to catch up on, and the information you took in at the seminar will be set aside as you focus on the stack of marking on your desk. This memo is about learning networks. Ah, learning networks. We've been here before. Remember Liverpool in 2006 when the local authority arranged all city schools into 10 different learning communities? Great idea. Put us in predetermined groups and make us talk to each other. But not about what we had for lunch or how the team lost again or latest fashion trends. No, the focus was to be learning only. Which is fair, I suppose. It is work after all, but it's hard to connect with the people in your group when all you know about them is their pedagogical philosophy. So they formed a committee to figure out how to let teachers talk to each other. A big committee, with senior management and people with fancy titles. This committee would oversee the learning network, and once established, participants could go ahead and create programs that allowed teachers to talk about learning. Only learning. A researcher named Mark O'Brien, along with some of his colleagues, interviewed the Learning Network coordinators and sent surveys to headmasters who were supposed to circulate the questionnaires to everyone else. Some did, but others didn't. For good reasons, probably. Like protecting us from extra work. Or maybe they answered on our behalf. We don't know. But only 16% of the staff responded. They wanted to see what we thought about the Learning Network and what the network meant to us. O'Brien read and sorted and categorized responses and wrote an interim report in 2006, making four broad observations about our attitudes. First, turns out a bunch of educators in general, but headmasters in particular, really believed that these learning networks were just part of the government's plan to get re-elected. Second, while no one has yet proven that a learning network directly contributes to individual student achievement, there are benefits for schools as a whole. Lots of respondents thought improving student achievement was the motivation behind their implementation. Third, we're not likely going to use the learning network for short-term stuff like getting help with next period's science class, but most of us do think it will be good for our long-term professional development. Whether a learning network will magically transform schools into something marvelous or not, most are doubtful. Fourth, headmasters, it seems, are more skeptical than most, especially those in secondary schools. They just know that despite the presence of a big steering committee, they are the ones that will have to sell it in the schools, even if they aren't real clear on the learning network's purpose. While some got on board with their staff, others waited to see what would happen. For everyone, time away from the classroom was an issue. So what did we learn? The Liverpool Learning Network fell from the top down onto teachers' desks. While educators wanted it to work and were hopeful that the initiative would make us better teachers and the students better learners, it was still viewed with skepticism. O'Brien and his colleagues learned from this experience that when it comes to creating a better experience for teachers and students, that ownership and independence and self-determination are important elements of a learning network. He suggested that if we ever do this again, our learning network should have clearly defined purpose and embody the noble values of trust, openness, and integrity. Now, it was around this time that social media and Web 2.0 had infiltrated daily life. Now, social media has a whole lot of stuff not about learning. But a bunch of university-type scholars got a hold of it and, without direction or mandate, started using Twitter's 140 characters to do serious stuff. Turns out social media can be whatever we want it to be, and these scholars turned it into a learning network. In 2010, George Velastianos got on Twitter and creeped a bunch of academics to find out how they use Twitter for their own professional learning. In order to be creep-worthy, the scholar had to be a PhD employed by a higher education institution with an active public Twitter profile and at least 2,000 followers. Not your typical tweep, to be sure, but the kind of Twitter user that could shed light on exactly how social networks could be used as learning networks. Velastianos had several researchers comb through, sort, and categorize the last 100 tweets from each of the 45 scholars he studied. He found that their tweets generally served seven functions: sharing things with each other, accessing learning opportunities, getting or giving advice, personal and professional branding activities, networking with others, bridging other social media platforms, and sharing trivial personal details. Lots of teachers would love to be able to do this more regularly, but never get the time to, and these scholars were doing it all on Twitter, on their own time, without anyone telling them they had to? Wow. Velastianos even acknowledged the contributions of trivial tweets to making connections with others. Sharing personal details publicly adds dimensionality to the online persona. Your "I'm listening to Burr Lives" tweet might make me more likely to talk with you now that I know you like Burr Lives too. One thing leads to another, and the next thing you know, we're collaborating on research proposals. Velastianos recognized that when the learning network is controlled by the individual, it has great capacity for change and specialization. The Twitter learning network can morph with the needs of the user, meaning that I can get what I need when I need it, and I don't need to feel guilty about telling everyone about the awesome lunch I had. So Velastianos found out what network learners are doing on Twitter. Rory C. found out why network learners find it so valuable. In 2013, C had a brainstorming session with 34 academics who had self-directed learning networks, but because it took place on Twitter, he called it a tweetstorm. Get it? Brainstorm? Tweetstorm? I wonder why they didn't just brainstorm in person. Maybe they couldn't get the time off to attend a meeting, so they just tweeted during the day from work. C was interested in the network's social relationships. He had participants describe the other people in the networks, who they were, how close they were, what did they learn from them, and how did they connect. He found that almost half were described as both colleagues and friends, and they talked mostly on Twitter, email, or face-to-face. In the tweetstorm, everyone talked about why they got involved with learning networks, what they liked about it, and why they think it's effective. Like Velastianos, C sorted, organized, and categorized the tweets and identified 7 factors contributing to professional learning. One is that they liked sharing. They're enthusiastic about the social aspects of learning. They find valuable information and resources in the network. They get feedback on their ideas, and they learn things from each other, and they feel a sense of trust and support, and their connections are good and intelligent people. C says that learning networks, even on social media, rely on the intrinsic rewards of give and take. What's different with social media is we can include people both near and far, socially close or distant, in a self-managed learning network that's integrated into our daily practice. So back to this memo, learning networks. It says management is now taking a grassroots, bottom-up approach to creating learning networks. This is either very ironic or very clever. They're basing this new approach on 2011 research by Irene Hanriots and her colleagues. She analyzed interviews of several people with experience facilitating professional learning networks and identified 5 broad challenges. Knowing the roles and interventions required to initiate a learning network, making it meaningful, developing digital communication skills, spurring independence, and finding a balance between online and in-person engagement. So the memo is about management's new understandings and approaches to learning networks, and they're incorporating solutions identified by Hanriots. The learning networks will be independent and self-directed. I get to say what I want to learn, and a facilitator will work with me to make initial connections with people and content that will help me meet those needs. The learning networks will be integrated into daily practice, and the facilitator will help me make time in my day to participate. The learning networks will use my choice of communication technology to connect and collaborate with the people both inside and outside the organization. The facilitator will even work with me to develop effective communication skills on social media and find opportunities for face-to-face meetings with some of the people in my learning network. No mandates, no directives, no restrictions on topics. This new approach, the memo says, is an effort to nurture a climate of learning throughout the organization. Sounds like it has what the Liverpool exercise was missing. Ownership, autonomy, degrees of self-direction, trust, openness, and integrity. I think I'm going to like this.